Good evening. We are all diminished by any death, and we're especially lessened by the death of one so close, but we are oh so much more due to the life and contributions of Kurt Vonnegut, whom we gather to remember and honor. Kurt Vonnegut was born on November 11, 1922, in Indianapolis, Indiana, and he died on April 11, 2007, in New York City. In accord with his wishes, he was memorialized by family and close friends in a private gathering 10 days later. So this is not a memorial service, but rather a time we pause to honor Kurt Vonnegut's humanism and to remember his humanity. I'm Tony Hileman, the senior leader of the New York Society for Ethical Culture, and I want to welcome you to our home. Ethical culture is part of the broader humanist community, and that we are a community is evidenced by our coming together this evening. Like those you will be hearing from later, and I would imagine like most of you here, this society is dedicated to betterment through personal and social growth and progress. And it has been since its founding in 1876. And this grand building, for those of you who are wondering, has been our home since 1910. So welcome. This evening is made possible through the cooperation and support of the American Humanist Association, where Kurt served as honorary president. And it takes place with the sanction, I would say blessing, but it doesn't seem quite appropriate, of the Vonnegut family. Kurt and I share a common heritage in Indianapolis, as I too was born and raised in there. I call him Kurt not because I knew him well, we didn't grow up or hang out together, but I call him Kurt because, like pretty much everyone here this evening, I feel like I knew him well. Anyone who read anything he wrote feels they knew him because he put so much of himself into his writing. And besides, to call him anything other than Kurt just wouldn't sound or feel right. My father was a carpenter in Indianapolis, and those sections of our house that he didn't build, he rebuilt. And there wasn't a screw or nail, a hinge or knob that went into that house that didn't come from the Vonnegut Hardware Company. Like Kurt, my favorite cousin, Gene, worked there during his high school years, being hired on at the behest of his surrogate mother, my aunt, who was a cashier there. Unlike Kurt, my cousin went on to a career in that business, transiting to those big box discount home centers that did in the smaller chains like that of Kurt's family. But Gene always had a soft spot for Vonnegut Hardware, as did most every Hoosier who shopped there. All this is by way of saying that I was predisposed to Kurt's writing from the get-go. And like so many others who came of age in the 1960s, they impacted my life. How many others here have had long and boozy conversations throughout the night trying to figure out what the hell he was talking about in Player Piano or Cat's Cradle? Those were precious and rewarding experiences as dark became dawn and we became, if not wiser, at least a bit more knowledgeable, and maybe even a little bit more mature. Kurt had a way of enlightening the naivete of youth and tempering the zealous optimism we humanists are all too prone to. He could and almost always was funny, but the lightness provoked heavy thoughts, as his son Mark reminds us in this message that he sent to to be read tonight. Kurt never told a joke that didn't have a serious point. He made his points well, about as well as they can be made. But in the end, he was depressed and discouraged about how little difference it seemed to make. With nothing on the side of war and everything on the side of peace, war wins. Hate and prejudice need nothing to thrive. Ethics, education, our best efforts guided by our best thinking seem to yield a few fragile hothouse plants that dry up and blow away the first time we forget to water them. It sure would be nice to win once in a while. As a child and a young man, he had abundant hope and pride. In the absence of things to be proud of about your culture, you're pretty much stuck with jokes. That was written yesterday morning, and Mark ends with one of Kurt's jokes from his last book, A Man Without a Country. Searching for the positive, for the silver lining, he asks, "What's the white stuff in bird poop?" Optimism failing him, he answers, "That's bird poop too." I have the enviable but difficult task this evening of introducing those who need no introduction. And if they do, you really need to step to the back of the hall and have your humanist credentials checked, because you can't be even peripherally involved in this movement without having heard of those who you'll be hearing from tonight. A leading voice for humanism in the United States and abroad, Fred Edwards was executive director of the American Humanist Association when Kurt Vonnegut became its honorary president in 1992. The same year he was honored as Humanist of the Year. Fred went on to be editor of the Humanist magazine, moved on to be AHA's editorial director, and eventually director of communications, the position he holds now. Along the way, he mentored a long list of humanists, myself among them, in various capacities at the AHA, the International Humanist and Ethical Union, and various other organizations within the community of reason. It was Fred who nurtured the AHA's relationship with Kurt, garnering a deep understanding and appreciation for his humanism in the process. He's here to share that with us this evening. Fred?
It was in a letter to members of the American Humanist Association, an organization he served, as was noted, as honorary president for the last 15 years of his life, that Kurt Vonnegut summed up his outlook with the words you see on the front of your program. "I am a humanist," he wrote, "which means in part that I've tried to behave decently without expectations of rewards or punishments after I am dead." Now that's a pretty short and direct, forthright expression of humanism, very honest and real. But that kind of direct humanism reached further back than his last decade and a half, further back than even his own life. On April 27th of this year, in his last interview, Kurt Vonnegut said to Heather Augustine, "My ancestors on both sides of the family came over here about the time of the Civil War. One of them lost a leg and went back to Germany. Anyway, they were all free thinkers. They were educated." Free thinkers. Historically, free thinkers have been people who thought for themselves on matters of religion, politics, social conventions, and other issues. They often saw themselves as the opposite of those with hidebound or traditional beliefs. They regarded those other people as sort of, well, what's a free thinker? It's the opposite of a slave thinker, was sort of the way they used to express it. people enslaved by convention and conformity. But beyond questioning authority, freethinkers were progressive social reformers who were behind many of the most significant 19th century movements for change. We often hear, for example, about the anti-slavery movement, and of course today, traditional Christian religion claims they were the great anti-slavers. But most people don't know that if you were an anti-slavery advocate before the Civil War, you were often called an atheist because so many freethinkers were at the forefront of that movement. Anyway, because of this history, Kurt Vonnegut regarded the freethinkers of old, many of whom were German immigrants, as just the same thing as today's humanists. But he added that during World War I, his family stopped using the term freethinker precisely because it tended to identify them as German, and Germans were hated in those years. Not surprisingly, it's around the time of World War I that the modern usage of the term humanist came into currency among people with much the same sorts of ideas. As it's defined today, humanism is a philosophy of life that views the universe as natural and humans as part of nature. On the subject of reliable knowledge, humanism recognizes only what is derived through observation, experimentation, critical thinking, and rational analysis, as opposed to the knowledge or truth claims of ancient authority, revelation, mysticism, and faith. And it sees ethical values as emerging from our nature as social animals and from human need, human interest, and human experience. There's more I could say, and with some nuance, but those are the central points. Kurt Vonnegut understood them well, but as always, he expressed them in his own unique way. For example, throughout his life, he held to the philosophical view that, from a cosmic perspective, existence is meaningless, but this is redeemed by human kindness, or, as he sometimes said, the few saintly people among us. This outlook was summed up in his 1965 novel, God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater, when he has his title character say, "Hello, babies. Welcome to Earth. It's hot in the summer and cold in the winter. It's round and wet and crowded. At the outside, babies, you've got about 100 years here. There's only one rule that I know of, babies. God damn it, you've got to be kind. Kind, yes, but not blindly kind." He stressed this latter point in his 1992 Humanist of the Year acceptance speech, which he entitled, "Why My Dog Is Not a Humanist." He was trying to say that he didn't want people to think that a humanist was simply somebody who's crazy about human beings like Will Rogers, who had never met one he didn't like. "No, that certainly didn't describe me," he said. "It would describe my dog, though." He had a dog named Sandy, and all Sandy paid any attention to was people, his tail wagging all the time. What a person looked like or smelled like didn't matter to Sandy. It could be a baby, it could be a drunk who hated dogs, it could be a young woman as voluptuous as Marilyn Monroe, it could have been Hitler, it could have been Eleanor Roosevelt. Whoever it was, Sandy would have wagged his tail. This disqualified Sandy as a humanist because a humanist is supposed to be more rationally discriminating. Moreover, humanists are, as Vonnegut said, strikingly secular in their interests and enthusiasms, not trying to factor God Almighty into their equations alongside everything perceived with our senses. By contrast, Sandy obviously worshiped not just me, but simply any person as though he or she were the creator and manager of the universe. In sum, lacking sufficient rationality, Sandy was simply too dumb to be a humanist. Now, Kurt Vonnegut didn't hold to any supernatural beliefs, including that of an afterlife. In his book, A Man Without a Country, he makes this plain as he recounts remarks he supposedly made at a humanist memorial service for Isaac Asimov. I say supposedly, because I don't think he ever actually spoke at such a service. The remarks in question were the ones I heard him make at his Humanist of the Year award ceremony, which took place about a month after Isaac's death. Isaac had been president of the American Humanist Association, and Kurt's words were these. "The sort of humanism I represent, to which I am an heir, draws energy not from the Renaissance or from an idealized pre-Christian Greece and Rome, but rather from the very recent scientific discoveries and modes of seeking truth. I myself at one time tried to become a biochemist, as did our darling, terribly missed brother, Isaac Asimov. He actually became one. I didn't have a chance. He was smarter than me. We both knew that, incidentally. He's in heaven now." What happened after he said that is correctly described in A Man Without a Country, with literary license granted for humorous exaggeration. Kurt wrote, "It was the funniest thing I could have said to an audience of humanists. I rolled them in the aisles. It was several minutes before order could be restored. And if I ever die, God forbid, I hope you will say, Kurt is up in heaven now. That's my favorite joke." Well, I got to know Kurt at that event because, unlike many other Humanists of the Year, he didn't merely show up for his award ceremony. He stayed for the whole Humanist conference that surrounded it, telling me he just wanted to hang out with the other attendees. I saw him chatting with fellow humanists in the hallways, sitting in on workshops, drinking and telling stories in the bar, especially with the cutest member of our board of directors, and coming along to the post-conference tour as we toured scenic Oregon outdoors. After he became our honorary president, I sometimes had cause to phone him up on some business or other, and he'd answer the phone himself. And then when I'd say who I was, he'd always respond, "I've heard of you." Sometimes I would request permission to quote something from one of his works and use it in something we were publishing, and he'd always grant it. But finally, in 2003, when he was 81, he got tired of my asking and just sent me a letter to end it all. I still have it. It reads, "Find here my permission for you to quote any damn fool thing I've ever said or written throughout all eternity and without any further notice or compensation from me." Next to the signature on that letter is the self-portrait seen on the front of your programs. But I digress. The point I was trying to get to is, Kurt is in heaven now. There's more to humanism, however, than opinions on only this sort of thing. And it's more than a worldview beyond the ken of other species or on the opposite pole from the ideas of religious fundamentalists. There are social values that naturally emerge from it: human rights, civil liberties, social justice, fairness, the open society, and humane concern. These stand in opposition to cruelty, such as torture of prisoners, or as its new euphemism indicates, detainee abuse. These stand in opposition to war, genocide, blind patriotism, disenfranchisement, poverty, and the despoilation of the environment. Kurt talked about those things too. In that final interview of his, he said, In the public schools, I learned what America was supposed to be. You know, a beacon of liberty to the rest of the world. And obviously, that wasn't the case. I wrote a letter to Iraq, an open letter signed Uncle Sam, and what it said was, "Dear Iraq, do like us. At the beginning of democracy, a bit of genocide and ethnic cleansing is quite okay. After 100 years, you have to let your slaves go. And after 150 years, you have to let your women vote and hold public office. Some democracy. Anyway, when I was young, I noticed these contradictions, and of course, they were quite acceptable to a lot of people, but not to me." Kurt Vonnegut talked and wrote about a wide range of humanist social issues. There are so many to choose from. Here's what he wrote on capital punishment in his final public speech, which he was to deliver in his hometown of Indianapolis. It was delivered instead after his death by his son Mark. Kurt wrote, "But listen, if anyone here should wind up in a gurney, in a lethal injection facility, maybe the one in Terre Haute, here's what your last words should be. This will certainly teach me a lesson." Such are the ways Kurt expressed his humanist views, but he also acted on them. In a 1983 article from Mother Jones, he wrote, "I made a lot of money, a lot for me, about 12 years ago, and my publisher took me over to the Chase Manhattan Bank to meet a money manager. I decided not to sign up with him, but he promised to do his best to make my money grow, even as the planet became poorer. It would keep pace with inflation and then some. As though to reassure me, he declared that he would not, in effect, allow his judgment to be addled by patriotism. If the United States turned out to be a relatively inhospitable place for my money, with workers getting high wages and expensive social benefits, and so on, he would send it all overseas." Beyond declining to hand his money over to those he termed anarchist money managers, Kurt also was proactive in his humaneness. A particularly well-known example was when he adopted his sister Alice's three children when she died of cancer. And so we celebrate tonight the humanism of Kurt Vonnegut, the ideas, the meaning, the expression, and how that humanism was lived. We also celebrate the humor, including his willingness to poke fun at occasional unrealistic aspirations of the more optimistic among humanists. Some humanists would say that in an ideal world, humanity could be brought together on those elements of common ground that we all share. Kurt tried his hand at this. In that final speech, he wrote, "I think we can come up with a statement on which all Americans, Republican or Democrat, rich or poor, straight or gay, can agree, despite our country being so tragically and ferociously divided. The first universal American sentiment I came up with was, sugar is sweet." And so indeed was the life of Kurt Vonnegut.
Thank you, Fred. As editor of the politically progressive magazine In These Times since 1986, our next speaker, Joel Bleifuss, has had more stories on Project's censored annual list of the 10 most censored stories than any other journalist. Kurt Vonnegut was senior editor there, and In These Times published most of his essays and many interviews in the recent years. Joe co-authored the book, "Was the 2004 Presidential Election Stolen?", which was released last year to much acclaim. And he worked with Kurt on Kurt's last book, "A Man Without a Country." His tongue-in-cheek commentary is a blend of critical insight and humor, not unlike that of the man he comes to remember and honor tonight. Joel?
Well, I'm very glad to be here, and if anybody's interested in listening to or reading Kurt's last interview, it's on our website, www.inthesetimes.com. Like Kurt, my ancestors on my father's side were freethinkers who immigrated from Germany to the Midwest in the 1860s. The freethinkers, like today's humanists, believed that people are free to make choices without divine help, that people share a common humanity, that there are ethical standards that should guide an individual's actions. Kurt never ceased to be outraged by man's inhumanity to man, and while he could always find a corner of joy in the world, the fate of which he often despaired, he was ever ready with a droll, one-line quip that would eviscerate the pretensions of the powerful. The most popular essay Kurt ever wrote for In These Times was titled "Cold Turkey." Every day after Thanksgiving, our website, is inundated with visits, people looking for innovative things to do with their Turkey Day leftovers. Rather than recipes, they get some Kurt Vonnegut wisdom. In that essay, Kurt wrote about two of the men he admired most. One was Jesus Christ. As Kurt the Humanist once put it, "I say of Jesus, as all humanists do, if what he said was good, and so much of it is absolutely beautiful, what does it matter if he was a god or not?" Anyway, in this cold turkey essay, he wrote, "For some reason, the most vocal Christians among us never mention the Beatitudes, but often, with tears in their eyes, they demand that the Ten Commandments be posted in public buildings. And of course, that's Moses, not Jesus. I haven't heard one of them demand that the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, be posted anywhere. Blessed are the merciful, in a courtroom. Blessed are the peacemakers, in the Pentagon. Give me a break." In that essay, he also invoked the great turn-of-the-century reformer Eugene Victor Debs, who, like him, was both a socialist and a Hoosier. Kurt wrote, "Eugene Debs, who died back in 1926 when I was only four, ran five times as a Socialist Party candidate for president, winning 900,000 votes, 6% of the popular vote, in 1912, if you can imagine such a ballot. He had this to say while campaigning, "As long as there is a lower class, I'm in it. As long as there is a criminal element, I'm of it. As long as there is a soul in prison, I am not free." And Kurt quipped, "Doesn't anything socialist make you want to throw up, like great public schools or health insurance for all?" For Kurt, the social gospel of Jesus and the socialist gospel of Debs expressed essential humanist ideals. I first met Kurt over the phone when I interviewed him in January 9, 2003, during those dark weeks leading up to the Bush administration's invasion of Iraq. During our talk, he rallied against the PPs, or psychopathic personalities, who had taken over the government by means of what he called the sleaziest, low-comedy, Keystone Cops-style coup d'etat imaginable. He was speaking, of course, of Bush and company. He went on to say, "Those now in charge of the federal government are upper-crust C students. Unlike normal people, they are never filled with doubts, for the simple reason that they cannot care what happens next, simply can't. Do this, do that, mobilize the reserves, privatize the public schools, attack Iraq, cut health care, tap everybody's telephone, cut taxes on the rich, build a $1 trillion missile shield, fuck habeas corpus and the Sierra Club, and in these times, and kiss my ass." That was Kurt's strength as a political essayist, an ability to give voice to common sense decency, accompanying it with a left hook that would leave the reader cheering. Was Kurt sometimes over the top? Perhaps. But also, he was remarkably sane during those months early in 2003, when millions of citizens around the world massed in the streets in protest, ignored by media mandarins and the Democratic poobahs who were busy nodding their assent as Bush marched the nation off a cliff to war. And were Kurt here, rather than up in heaven, it is not likely that he would be talking to you without addressing the war in Iraq, a war that challenges us to aspire to an ethical standard that values blood more than oil, that puts community before empire, and that exalts human reason over blind allegiance to authority. This past Memorial Day, the Vietnam Veterans Against the War and their younger brothers and sisters in the Iraq Veterans Against the War invited me to speak at a service at the Vietnam War Memorial on the banks of the Chicago River in downtown Chicago. They knew that in the last years of his life, Kurt had taken the warmongers in Washington to task on the pages of In These Times with that same blend of scorn and humor as he had during the Vietnam War 40 years previously. During the service, I read this passage that Kurt had written about war. "In 1968, the year I wrote Slaughterhouse-Five, I finally became grown up enough to write about the bombing of Dresden. It was the largest massacre in European history. I, of course, know about Auschwitz, but a massacre is something that happens suddenly. It's killing a whole lot of people in a very short time. In Dresden, about 135,000 people were killed on February 13, 1945, by the British firebombing of Dresden in one night. It was pure nonsense, the pointless destruction of that city. The whole city was burned down, and it was a British atrocity, not ours. They sent in night bombers, and they came in and they set the whole town on fire with a new kind of incendiary bomb. And so everything organic, except my little POW group, was consumed by fire. It was a military experiment to find out if you could burn a whole city down by scattering incendiaries all over it. Of course, as prisoners of war, we dealt hands-on with dead Germans, digging them out of basements because they had suffocated there, and taking them to a huge funeral pyre. Why my fellow prisoners of war and I weren't killed, I don't know. I was a writer in 1968. I was a hack. I'd write anything to make money, you know, and what the hell, I'd seen this thing, I'd been through it, and so I was going to write a book, hack book about Dresden. You know, the kind that would be made into a movie and where Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra and all them would play us. I tried to write, but just couldn't get it right. I kept writing crap. So I went to a friend's house, Bernie O'Hare, who'd been my pal, and we were trying to remember funny stuff about our time as prisoners of war in Dresden, tough talk and all that stuff. That would make a nifty war movie, and his wife, Mary O'Hare, blew her stack. She said, "Why don't you tell the truth for a change? You were nothing but babies then." And that is true of soldiers. They are, in fact, babies. They are not movie stars. They are not Duke Wayne, and realizing that was the key. I was finally free to tell the truth. We were children, and the subtitle of Slaughterhouse-Five became The Children's Crusade. I think the Vietnam War freed me and other writers because it made our leadership and our motives seem so scruffy and essentially stupid. We could finally talk about something bad that we did to the worst people imaginable, the Nazis, and what I saw and what I had to report made war look so ugly. You know, the truth can be a really powerful stuff. You're not expecting it. Of course, one reason not to talk about war is that it's unspeakable. Donald Rumsfeld wondered if Americans had stomach enough for casualties. No, we don't. We don't like casualties. Most of us live happy never to have killed anybody. I didn't kill anybody in the Second War, thank God. But these guys, these neocons, think killing is a perfectly ordinary thing to do. That strikes me as very un-American. War is murder, and war veterans have committed murder, and that's a rather serious thing to do. And we now have children who are committing murder, for us now being horribly mistreated. In all our wars, never have soldiers been so mistreated by the commander-in-chief so heartlessly. Well, those are all Kurt's words. And I've always taken what Kurt said about himself and the young men he fought with alongside as being children as sort of a commentary on their youth and innocence, not a literal statement. But recent research at the National Institutes of Health shows that in a physiological sense, many US soldiers are children. In the last issue of In These Times, our health and science columnist, Terry Allen, wrote about the teenagers currently serving in the US military. It turns out that according to NIH researchers, the brains of children in their late teens are still undergoing substantial changes, particularly the prefrontal cortex, which the researchers describe as the area of sober second thought. A mature prefrontal cortex is vital not only to deciding whether to enlist, but also to choices made under the stress of deployment and the terrors of combat. According to NIH researchers, this area of the brain is important for controlling impulses, and what's more, is among the last regions of the brain to mature. In fact, it doesn't reach adult dimensions until the early 20s. In other words, the brains of the 81,000 teenagers currently serving in the US Armed Forces simply lack the impulse control that can prevent a lifetime of regret, psychological and physical disability, and preventable deaths, their own, their fellow soldiers, and those of civilians. Earlier this month, while editing Terry Allen's column, I kept thinking that Kurt would have had some choice words to say about America's child soldiers if he had known this. The world will miss this man who kept his moral compass always pointed in the left direction. It was In These Times' pleasure and privilege to publish the work of Kurt Vonnegut. We applauded his humanist ethics, his one-off sense of humor, and his in-your-face contempt for beltway venality. We have lost a citizen who spoke for us all. So it goes. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel. Howard Zinn is an American historian, social critic, playwright, political scientist, and social activist. He's also an American treasure. Professor emeritus in the political science department at Boston University, he's a prolific writer who has authored numerous books. One, A People's History of the United States, has sold over 1 million copies. Kurt Vonnegut spoke at the event, recognizing that accomplishment by his friend. He read the words of Mark Twain, for whom he named his son, who spoke out after President Theodore Roosevelt congratulated a general involved in the 1906 Moro Crater massacre in the Philippines. Twain said, and Kurt read, "It should, it seems to me, be our pleasure and duty to make these people free and let them deal with their own domestic questions in their own way. And so I am an anti-imperialist. I am opposed to having the eagle put its talons on any other land." Kurt Vonnegut and Howard Zinn each have labored long and hard in support of that sentiment. Howard?
Thank you. Well, thank you all for coming here to honor Kurt Vonnegut. Program, it says, identifies me as a longtime friend. I'm not sure what that means. Not that long, but I was always, for a very long time, plus very long time, I read Kurt Vonnegut, loved his writing, but had never met him, actually, until, 10 years ago, I got a phone call. Very rich telephone voice. Is this Howard Zinn? This is Kurt Vonnegut. Well, how would you feel? I was willing to speak to him. Anyway, he was calling me up because he read an essay of mine on Machiavellianism and American foreign policy, and he liked it and so on. Well, that was the beginning of a friendship, and a lot of it conducted over the telephone. You wouldn't expect Kurt Vonnegut to do email, would you? No. A lot of it over the telephone, letters. We met a few times in New York, and he would call up. When he called up, he had something very specific. For instance, once he called, I wasn't home, but he called to give my wife the recipe for a Manhattan, which he thought would put us in the right mood. And she dutifully took down all the ingredients and actually went out and got them because she felt that, she couldn't desist from doing that after he had gone to this trouble. Anyway, he would call it. Yeah, very specific thing. He called up once after his friend Joseph Heller died. Joseph Heller, the author of Catch-22. He referred to Heller as a holy clown, which is a phrase that could just as well have been applied to Kurt Vonnegut. Said something, yeah. A holy clown. He and Joseph Heller, of course, have a lot in common. Heller had written Catch-22, he had written Slaughterhouse-Five. Both of them were comic masterpieces and yet serious commentaries on World War II. Very serious, because what they did was to break away from the customary romanticization of World War II and have us look
at even the so-called good war, the best of wars, look at that war in a different and more critical light, you know. As with remembering Hiroshima, which was never far from Kurt's mind, Hiroshima, Nagasaki. And one time he sent me a copy of a letter that he had sent to the New York Times. At that time, the newspapers were full of kind of hysteria about other countries developing a nuclear weapon. Well, we still have that, right? Just as we were hysterical about weapons of mass destruction. Well, Korea developing a nuclear weapon. Iraq, Iran, Iran may develop a nuclear weapon. One, perhaps in 5 years, and all this excitement. And Vonnegut's letter to the New York Times, one sentence, said, I know of only one country that has dropped a nuclear bomb on innocent people. The New York Times did not print that letter. So much for freedom of the press. They couldn't claim that the letter was too long. But Kurt opposed the Vietnam War, spoke against it. He opposed the first Gulf War. He opposed the current war against Iraq. Once we had lunch in New York, not far from his Midtown apartment where he lived, and with his wife, Jill Kremens, and we talked about the need to get beyond opposing this war or that war. How many wars are we going to oppose? What's going to happen after the Iraq War? We're going to have another anti-war movement and then another anti-war movement? Isn't it time for the human race to decide that war cannot be accepted as a solution for any problem that exists in the world? Isn't it time to call for the abolition of war? Well, we talked about that. Kurt wrote what for me was, you know, this remarkable book, which probably has reached more people than sort of any other of Kurt's work. Millions and millions of people have read Cat's Cradle. And it's a wild and crazy book with nuggets of a profound wisdom buried here and there in the pages. And those of you who know the book will know he invented words, he invented phrases. Of course, he always invented characters and people. He invented the word Grand Falloon. And Grand Falloon represented what he called a false carass, another one, it was a word. That is a false assemblage, an artificial assemblage of people who don't really belong together. He cited, you know, the Daughters of the American Revolution, the Communist Party, General Electric, and as he put it, all nations, anywhere, anytime. He understood that nations were artificial creations, that they didn't deserve to encompass their citizens in some kind of box in which they could say, oh, we are all this and we are all that, and they are somebody else, and therefore it's all right to make war on them. He understood that very well. So I always cherished Cat's Cradle, if only for that. Kurt was a socialist. That is in the old-fashioned sense, in the best sense of the term, in the Eugene Debs sense, in the Mother Jones sense of the term, in the Helen Keller sense of the term. He believed in a decent society. He was offended by the way the word socialism became associated with bureaucratic despotisms here and there in the world, and he wanted to recapture it. Didn't want to be afraid of using the word socialist. In his book, Jailbird, he expresses his, I started to say anger, but anger was not that Kurt represented. His kind of, kind of humorous but deep-seated opposition to the pretenses of capitalism. And he had, in this book, he had one of his favorite characters, Kilgore Trout, who some of you may remember, who would appear in his books again and again. And Kilgore Trout, it was a story within a story, because Kilgore Trout wrote a short story. And the short story was called Asleep at the Switch. And in the story, just outside the pearly gates, you can see how religious Kurt was, just outside the pearly gates, there was a reception area. And you couldn't get in unless you got the approval of the people in this reception area. The people in this reception area were accountants and investment counselors. And they tested you to see if you had made wise business decisions. And if you hadn't made wise business decisions, you would not make it through the pearly gates, and you would be labeled asleep at the switch. And the story ends with Albert Einstein appearing at the pearly gates. And they discover that Albert Einstein never made a wise business decision in his life, and so he's denied admittance. Anyway, you get an idea of what Kurt thought about the capitalist system. And, a lot has been said about Kurt and his attitude towards religion and his humanism and his not ferocious attitude towards religion, because he didn't have a ferocious attitude towards anyone, but he was very serious about these things in his own way. And in one of his books, I think it's in Jailbird, he has this woman named Ruth, who is a survivor of the concentration camps, and someone asks her, when you were in the concentration camp and going through all that hell, did you feel the need to turn to religion? And she said, no, because I knew that God wouldn't come anywhere near this concentration camp. She said, the Nazis had a better idea of God than anybody else. They knew where God would come and where he wouldn't come, you see. And this woman who came out of the concentration camp, on Christmas Eve, she proposed a toast. A toast to God, the laziest man on earth. Yeah. So, very often Kurt was accused of being a pessimist, which was, it's very easy to understand that accusation, because very often when you talk to Kurt or when you read his writings, you thought, my God, we're doomed. The earth is on its way out, and there's nothing we can do about it. And And of course, I would not call it pessimism, I would call it a kind of sadness that he had. He referred to the time when, right after World War II, when he had a certain hope that the world would be different now. I remember myself at the end of World War II, because like Kurt, I was in World War II. He had been underground in Dresden. I was flying overhead, dropping bombs, you see. But I remember at the end of World War II, getting a letter from General Marshall. He was the general of generals in World War II. It wasn't exactly a personal letter. 16 million people in the military got that letter. 16 million veterans of World War II got the same letter, and the letter said something like, "Congratulations, we've won the war. It will be a new world." Well, of course, it was not a new world, and it hasn't been a new world, and Kurt became very intensely aware of this, and he talks about how at the end of World War II, he had the hope that, as he put it to a friend of his in the army, he had hope that America would become more socialistic and that our children would grow up not worried about food or shelter and not being fearful of what might happen to them. That was the hope he had after World War II. And so there was a certain great sadness in Kurt about how this hope, you know, had not materialized. And yet, despite this, and it's very, very important to note this, despite this, he had an amazing faith in human beings. And at one time, he would talk about when somebody would bring up, as sometimes people do, the notion of, we're doomed because of where we come from and who we are. It's sort of built into us. And they talk about, and it's either biblical or genetic, but they talk about original sin. And Kurt would say, well, yes, there is original sin, but there is also original virtue. Look around. At one point, a woman wrote to Kurt, and she said, I'm bearing a child. She said, but I really wonder, should I bear a child into this terrible world? And Kurt responded that, he said, what makes me almost glad to be alive, you notice the word almost, he could never be totally confident, but he said, what makes me almost glad to be alive is all the saints that I have met, all the good people who have done wonderful things in the world and who continue to do wonderful things. And then in this book, Kurt addresses the reader, and he says, perhaps you, dear reader, can become a saint for her sweet child to meet. Sometimes people would ask Kurt, why do you write? Why do you continue to write? And his response was, I write because I want you to know that I feel as you do, that I have the same thoughts and the same feelings that you do. I write so that you won't feel alone. And so it occurs to me there are millions of people in the world, millions of people in the world who, reading Kurt Vonnegut, no longer felt alone. And to me, this is perhaps his greatest legacy. Thank you.
Amy Goodman has demonstrated her journalistic fearlessness numerous times on different continents. Tonight, she demonstrates her courage by agreeing to follow Howard Zinn. Fresh from receiving an honorary doctorate from the College of Staten Island today, Amy's perhaps best known as the host of what many consider the most significant progressive broadcast outlet in America, Democracy Now! But there's much more to her. Her list of laurels as an investigative journalist is long and spans the globe. Her best-selling books have established her as what the Los Angeles Times calls the voice of the disenfranchised left. But she speaks for more than those who agree with her or share her political views. She is, in her own words, dedicated to giving a voice to those who have been forgotten, forsaken, and beaten down by the powerful. She's here to lend her voice to honoring Kurt Vonnegut's humanism and to draw a bit more from the voices you've already heard, but I'll let her explain that. Amy?
The only thing that gives me courage about following Howard is that I simply get to ask him more questions. But I'd also like to open the discussion to everyone here and to you, but very specifically, because I'd like to make this an audience conversation. If people would like to share perhaps conversations you had with Kurt, if you knew him personally, or the effect a particular book had on you, we would really love to hear that and weave it into the conversation. So think about that. I'll just hand you the mic at the corner because we weren't really planning to do it that way, but I thought it would be a nice idea. Kurt Vonnegut was remarkably optimistic given how surrounded by death he was. His mother committing suicide on Mother's Day when he was 22. Being a prisoner of war, surviving the Dresden bombing as so many people did not. His sister dying 2 days after her husband died, and so adopting their children as his own. He is always, for me, someone I remember in those words that you quoted at the beginning, because it was my father's favorite saying, that end of that quote, "God damn it, you've got to be kind." But I wanted to ask Howard. Howard, you're the same age as Kurt, 84. You were completely contemporaries. When you first came to read, not meet, but read Kurt's book, which book did you read?
The first book of Kurt's that I read was Slaughterhouse-Five, to which I was sort of naturally drawn, because it was about the bombing of Dresden, because I had been flying bombing missions over Europe, and everything connected with World War II and bombing interested me. And I wanted to see what his point of view was, and his point of view became clear to me, which he expressed in his own odd, everything he did was odd, in his own odd way. And I was enormously moved and impressed by that book. One of the things that occurred to me was that after World War II, it seemed that it would have been impossible for anybody in the United States, after all of the glow that surrounded World War II, almost impossible for somebody to simply write an essay questioning the goodness of the good war, or at least raising questions about the purity of that war, or at least suggesting that there was moral ambiguity in that war. Almost impossible for anybody to write an essay or a book making that point. But it could be done in an odd way. It could be done indirectly. It could be done through fiction. It could be done through humor. And that's why Joseph Heller did what he did, and Kurt Vonnegut did what he did. And I thought it was a tremendous eye-opening for me and for so many people.
Joel, what was the editing process like? What was it like to edit Kurt Vonnegut?
Well, he was very, very precise in his language, and so a comma, an article, everything was could only absolutely be one way. So there was no give and take. But if I had sort of turned quite a few of his speeches into essays, and so he would allow me to cut out whole chunks, rearrange things, rewrite sentences so that they would flow into the next. And if he agreed with how it sounded and how it worked, he would say, "Fine, great job." He did everything by fax, a lot of the editing. So it would come back with the big scrawl mark, "This is crap." And you sort of had to sometimes have a thick skin with him, but it was never he was never mean. He was just very demanding of himself and everybody else. And so he would, he would call on the phone very, very often and have very, very short conversations. They would last maybe 10 seconds, 20 seconds, and he just then, as abruptly as he called, hang up. But to me, who as a young teenager sort of idolized him and I'd read all his books, and I was very nervous working with him at first, but he became a good friend in the last few years, and I think he taught me a lot about sort of humor in writing, because he could, just his phrasing was very subtle, and I would try to edit something and he would write back and change it, and then I'd look at how he had changed the flow of the sentence, and you could see, okay, yeah, that works much better.
Now, if anyone has any comment you'd like to share or experience, just come to the front and we'll give you a microphone, no matter how small or how big. Fred, would you like to start with another story of Fred? Not that you were the closest of friends, but as fellow humanists, another experience that you had with him.
Sure. Well, this sort of picks up on the editing points he made, but in a way, you knew what you were doing, and I didn't, in a way. I had asked, when I was executive director of the American Humanist Association, I asked Kurt first, could we write a letter soliciting funds for the organization and put your name on it? He said, no, because I've done that before, and some of my readers don't like it because it doesn't sound like me. And, of course, nobody could quite sound like him, so I could see that. So I said, well, can you write me something that I can use in a fund drive letter? And he wrote me something very short. And it's taken me all these years to realize the joke was on me. He said, if you don't support now the largest humanist organization in the hemisphere, it's going to sink like a stone. And we all need to stand up for humanism and the Second Amendment. And I scratched my head over that. The Second Amendment. What is he trying to do here? So we all puzzled over it in the offices, and I called him up and I said, "Well, can I edit this thing? Better for our purposes?" "Oh yeah, I've given it to you. Do what you want with it. Yeah, just change it any way you like." So I cut out the part about the Second Amendment and put it at the front of our fund drive letter that if people didn't support the American Humanist Association, the largest humanist organization in the hemisphere, it was going to sink like a stone. And, well, it worked. People gave us money, but gosh, that was a joke on us. and it's taken me a long time to pick up on it.
I, like I'm sure everyone here, was a huge Kurt Vonnegut fan since high school. And I quit reading him in 1973 when I had a huge crisis in my life and I didn't like Breakfast of Champions. And then in 1998, I read Timequake and I said, my God, why did I stop reading this guy? Anyway, I got a job on 2nd Avenue and 48th Street, like in 2003, and was walking down the block from the subway and looked up at a stoop at a house and saw a guy at the top of the stoop who looked a lot like Kurt Vonnegut. And I said, Kurt Vonnegut? And he gave me quite a look, like, yeah, so what? So about a year and a half passed, and I had occasion to write him a letter, which, oddly enough, was pointing out similarities between him, who I'd idolized in high school, and Charles Schulz, the creator of Peanuts, who I'd idolized as a kid. And 2 days later, I came home, and there was a postcard from Kurt with his little drawing on it. And so the next time I saw him on the street, I introduced myself as the guy who'd written him the letter about Charles Schulz, etc. And so from then on, for the next 2 years almost, we'd greet one another, and I'd speak to him periodically whenever I saw him on the block. And the longest conversation I ever had with him, I'm going to relate, because 2 weeks after he died, in the New York Times, there was a nice article which had a photograph of him and what said it was his little dog, Flower, and that he was often seen in the neighborhood, written by a guy who lived in the neighborhood who never worked up the nerve to speak to him, and I felt very blessed that I had sort of gotten to know him. Anyway, the longest conversation I ever had with Kurt was walking down the block. He was walking this tiny little dog, and I walked up to him and said, God, Kurt, I've never seen you with a dog before. I didn't know you had a dog. He goes, this isn't my dog. It's my wife's dog. I'd never own a little dog like this. If I owned a dog, it would be some, you know, like a Labrador. And then he said, Labradors are so friendly, they'll go home with anybody. And so I was sort of astonished when hearing the whole business about his dog not being a humanist, since it was essentially along the exact same lines as his little joke. Anyway, that's about it.
Yeah, you're just a friend of my daughter. But I visited him at his house in Cape Cod, and I've subsequently gone on to become a travel guide writer. So I had to travel around the world and pick out restaurants. So my technique for picking out restaurants is you look for a place where people look like they're having fun. And when I visited him at his house in Cape Cod, it was filled up with children, and everybody looked like they were having fun. It didn't have, you know, I've also had to deal with teenagers subsequently. And usually, you know, I'm not one of those people who say, why do you talk to your mother like that? But none of the kids were like that. All the kids seemed to be free and energetic and healthy. So, I mean, I think that was probably one of Kurt Vonnegut's greatest virtues, is all the kids must have turned out good. I mean, I know, because I mostly sleep with fucked up ones. All right, thank you very much.
Any other thoughts? Come on up.
I guess I'm better than here. I was lucky enough to learn about Kurt Vonnegut and read him in Russian translation when I was reasonably young with those non-formed frontal cortex functions. So I imbibed quite a few of my current values from reading him. I believe the first book I was reading was A Cat's Cradle, and it was quite a blow. I mean, I've never read anything like this before. And he was working with his Russian translator, right, Kovalova, personally. They really like tried to coin how to translate his books into Russian really well, and it worked. It was a beautiful translation. I reread it right later on in English, and I didn't regret that the Russian was the first language that I read Kurt in. I was often reproachful of him with my later understanding, like some of the things that sounded like cynicism to me and lack of belief of where humanity can go from here. Like, that disappointed me. I actually wanted to meet him and tell him, like, look, there is a hope for humanity. Humans can do better than this if they put their minds to it. And I was actually able to meet him once at the reading of the Borders bookstore, and but I didn't have a chance to speak to him in depth. He was whisked away by his chaperones. And I'm grateful to him for everything that he's done for humanity. It's a great loss for all of us that he's gone now. But his books are with us. We no doubt will return back to it, and the future generations will turn to them for wisdom and humanity. And the last thing I want to say, I want to thank Kurt Vonnegut and some other people who are here for signing the call to drive out the Bush regime with the organization called World Can't Wait. Thank you, Kurt, for everything.
I just wanted to share that when I heard of his death and how he died, I was sad, of course, as many of us. But I could just kind of hear, he had a fall, he fell on his head, and I could kind of hear him saying, don't be sad, I was really dumb and I fell on my head. And I could just kind of hear him saying that. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, real quickly, one after the other, just come on up.
Sorry. Should I come back?
Go ahead.
Okay, I saw Kurt in church once. It was the Church of Stop Shopping, which is a creation of Bill Talon. The character is Reverend Billy, who worships the God that is not a product. And he has fabulous worship services at St. Mark's Church. And this was last year. Kurt, he wasn't feeling that well that night, so we had to leave halfway through the service. But I was touched that he felt the need to be around this very, very cutting edge, very evolved energy downtown. There was Kurt in the front row, in the front pew. And actually, there's the keyboard player for Reverend Billy back there, Rick Ulfick. And Kurt did go to church. Okay.
Last person. Yeah, one more person right there. What? Right behind you. Your last person.
A few months ago, a friend of mine gave me A Man Without a Country. I read it. And I told my friend it was the perfect gift. My reading list had been too long to put it on my reading list before, but I very much enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, before we wrap up with Tony, I wanted to ask Howard, there's a big difference between you and Kurt in the level of pessimism, I think, and optimism. What makes you so optimistic?
I'm not that optimistic. I'm trying. I think, let's put it this way. With Kurt, there was a kind of mixture of sadness and hope, and with me, there's a mixture too. It's just that, you know, as in different ways of pouring a Manhattan, the different proportions, and maybe my proportion of hope is a little higher than Kurt's, but it's really based on
the same ingredient of hopefulness that Kurt saw, and that is that he saw virtuous people everywhere. He saw good people everywhere. I go around the country, and I see everywhere, however small the town, in any part of the country, there are good people working against war, working for equality everywhere. And, you know, I'm so, so yes, it's these people that make me emphasize the second part of Kurt. Yeah, original sin, but yes, original virtue, you see. And I guess there's one more thing that guards me against becoming too pessimistic, and that is a certain sense of history and a realization that all through history, people have faced at various points terrible situations which made them feel hopeless, and yet at certain points in history they overcame that. And by refusing to be hopeless, by refusing to be passive, by insisting on acting without any guarantee of success. But, you know, I'm thinking of black people in the South. I'm thinking of women in the women's movement. I'm thinking of the people in the movement against the war in Vietnam. But I'm thinking of the anti-slavery movement before the Civil War. And when people, against all odds, tackled the problems and wouldn't give up, at certain points in history, they succeeded. It isn't inevitable that movements succeed, but it's possible. And it's that possibility, just that possibility, based on history, that gives me some hope. Yes.
There's an old Hoosier expression that certainly applies here, and that is that Kurt Vonnegut was good people. He's gone, but Kilgore Trout and Mr. Rosewater are still with us. On behalf of the New York Society for Ethical Culture and the American Humanist Association, we hope that this has been a meaningful and rewarding experience for you. If you'd like to know more about either of our organizations, you can find information in the lobby. I want to take this opportunity to again thank our presenters so much. They all took time from overcrowded schedules on short notice to be with us. Thank you. And I want to thank each and every one of you for being here and adding to our experience. And I'll close with Kurt's own closing words. As was mentioned earlier, he was scheduled to deliver the McFadden Memorial Lecture at Butler University in Indianapolis on April 27th. Fortunately, he finished the text for that talk a couple of months early, sent a copy to his son Mark, who delivered it for him on that date. This is the last line. I thank you for your attention, and I'm out of here.